Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Would you sit down, please? It's very pleasing to see some faces who have been following the services on Sundays and sometimes on Wednesdays online over the past weeks. It is so much better for us to be here together in person. And I greet also those who are still online. They can't see me at the moment because I'm not in the line of the camera, but I still greet them and wish you all a very happy Easter. We are still in the season of COVID, even though Easter has begun. And so I have to make announcements which are meant to keep us all as safe as possible while we are in this building. First of all, it is the law that you must, unless you are exempt or you are doing something like I am speaking, you must wear a face covering over both nose and mouth throughout this service. So please do observe that and keep each other safe in that way. This church is big enough that we have made an invariable rule that unless you are in a bubble with someone else, you must keep at least 2 meters away from each other. And if you can make sure that where you are seated, you are at least 2 meters away from the other people, that is going to be very helpful. Please be aware that the side aisle pews are not quite 2 meters long. So 2 meters is a little further than you might think it is. Please do not attempt to sing at any point. This is quite difficult, especially on Easter Sunday. I'm sorry again about that, but congregational and community singing is still banned. We are allowed to have a small choir, which a couple of weeks ago we weren't even allowed to have. We are allowed to have up to 3 cantors. And I'm very grateful to the choir for providing the music today. If they're as good as the 4 who sang last night for the Easter Vigil, it will be exquisite. And I really do mean that. I am also sorry that you may be in a place where you are not most comfortable. You have had to have allocated places so that we can make sure everybody fits. That's just to make sure everyone's safe, and just because we don't want to have anybody standing outside because we couldn't fit them in. Fortunately, there are still places, and no doubt if there are latecomers, they will fit in there in the baptistry and also in the East End. So I'm glad of that, and I'm glad that we can be here together this morning. I think that covers everything that I need to say at the beginning of this Mass, so I will invite the choir to begin with a note of joy. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son.
Thank you.
the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia! Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia!
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. Although this Easter is still contrasting with other Easters when we've been able to stand and sing and join in the celebration, it contrasts most of all with last Easter, when the self-imposed interdict led clergy to be excluded from their churches, and I led Easter worship online from my dining room with the paschal candle on the hearth. What a transformation. Life comes from death, and we have lived and survived through this time in which at times it has felt like death, and for some people it has meant death. And yet Easter is about life not only coming from death, but transforming death, changing death. The life of Christ changes everything. And we have come here today not only to join in the celebration of life, but also to assert our firm faith that the life of Christ is the only life in which we live and the only life which is worth living. In word and sacrament today, we will encounter him. So not simply in symbols like the paschal candle and all the beautiful things which are in this church. And as we encounter him in person, we recognize the times when our faith has failed, the times when we have not lived in him. We recognize those things we call sin, and we ask for God's generous forgiveness. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Thank you.
for life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him. Grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was... He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most of the Easter sermons and messages that you will have read already will have had something to do with the new life of spring. It's inevitable, because the Passover falls in the Northern Hemisphere spring, so Easter falls in the Northern Hemisphere spring, and so Easter is associated with the new growth of flowers and plants and trees and all the other miracles which are going on around us. And of course, the addresses are filled with that too. I may have been guilty of that on occasions myself in the past. But my friends in the Southern Hemisphere, where it is well into autumn by now, and some of whom may be with us online, will find that just a little bit difficult to listen to and preach about, because nature is telling them a completely different story. And actually, their puzzlement would be right. Because although the things of nature reflect the things of God, they are not the things of God. This morning, saying morning prayer, I looked out of the window, and there I could see the half moon still in the light sky. It was fascinating. The half moon always is, especially when it appears during the day. And I got a little glimpse, and I don't often get glimpses like this, of something which goes beyond the three dimensions in which we live. Think about it. We often talk about two-dimensional words on a page, a two-dimensional picture on the television. 3D TV was a fad for a while, but people seem happy with high quality 2D TV, so it stays like that. And the three dimensions have to be made up in our imaginations. But for a moment there was a sense of wonder and a sense of wondering about the moon, about the fact that I can look at it, and yet in my lifetime I'm very unlikely ever to be offered a chance to stand on it, let alone the stars and the galaxies. And I had that little bit of a sense of wonder, which I wouldn't call a fourth dimension. I would call that a further dimension, and I identify it, at least in my own life, as a God dimension. It's misleading if we simply use all the signs and symbols of Easter and stay there. Because as I pointed out at the Easter Vigil, Jesus has not been resuscitated. That's a three-dimensional thing. That's what Jesus did to a couple of people in the Gospels. He brought them back to life so that they would live and die again. They would remain in the three dimensions in which we exist. The resurrection of Jesus opens to us and to the whole world a God dimension. Something completely new. Something for which, from the very beginning of creation, we were destined. We were destined to share in that God dimension. And the scriptures tell us, through the mystery of evil in the world and through the mystery of personal sin, we have excluded ourselves from that God dimension. We had made our spiritual eyes blind. We had made our spiritual ears not to hear. We had dulled our spiritual senses. And it took somebody blowing those three dimensions apart, Jesus on the cross. It took somebody who was God to show that there is a God dimension, and not only to show it, but to open it to all who will open their hearts, open their minds, open their eyes, their ears, their senses, and their whole being to the God who in Jesus has made eternal life possible. For some of the things about this fourth dimension, this God dimension, are wondrous. They're not miracles as we understand them. They go above miracles. They mean we can survive through difficult times. They mean we can have hope when the three-dimensional world gives us no hope at all. They mean that even in the greatest of difficulties, with that God dimension alongside us and in us, we can overcome. And they mean that when we face the greatest limitation of humankind, the limitation of death, we can know that it is not the end. The three dimensions pass away, to paraphrase St. Paul. The fourth dimension, the life of the resurrection, the eternal life, that spiritual life, that life of God, that God dimension, is forever. My friends, you and I have shared, or maybe some hope to share, in that dimension through baptism. In baptism, that possibility is opened to us. We become believers, but not only believers with heart and mind, we become people for whom the God dimension has been opened up. So don't get stuck today with the lovely things of spring and of Easter. Please enjoy them. As I said to the people at the Easter Vigil last night, we weren't allowed to have champagne and Easter eggs after the Easter Vigil, but that did not prohibit people from doing that when they got home. Celebrate, be happy, be joyful, but know where that joy comes from. That joy comes from something which is in you, which wells up to eternal life. That joy comes from the life of God in you that wells up to eternal life. That joy comes from the God dimension, which will never, ever go away from you unless you push it. And that life comes because on that first Good Friday, Jesus was willing in his death to die to the three dimensions in which we live, and in his resurrection to blow them apart, so that we know that God reigns, God lives, Jesus is alive, and in him so are we. Alleluia! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia! We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with the risen Christ, let us pray to the Father. In the Anglican Communion cycle of prayer, we are asked today to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And in this parish, we pray for all who are not able to be here today, for all who have shared in the other celebrations of the Easter Mass, here at 8:30 at the Easter Vigil and at St. Leonard's, that they may be filled with Easter joy, and that they may both appreciate and live the life of God which is in them through the resurrection of Jesus. We pray too for those who find hope difficult, and for those who, like the women returning from the tomb, are afraid. Afraid to believe in these times of COVID, afraid to go out, afraid of all manner of things, that fear may be overcome, and that those who create and nurture fear may be done away with. As we pray for the sick, we remember by name Baby Thea, Richard Harrison, Tony Reagan, Sandra Jones, Christopher Brown, Lodovico Mirani, John Robinson, Sheila Laverick, Joan Lydgate, Daisy Wallace, and Valerie Alice Seeley, members of the Wolf Kid family, Anthony and Katie, Teddy, June Franklin, John Herring, Michael Catton, Patricia Mitchell, Sue Hastings, Jean Maiden, Jane Jackson, David Staves, Laura, Tom Pierce, Ray Hearn, Margaret, Paul Taylor, Jane Stretton, Kenneth Hughes, and Robin Glasson. And as we remember those who have gone before us in faith. We pray for Albert Phipps, Ivy Rosling, and George Wilson, whose year's mind occurs today, and also for William Davis, Margaret Davis, Severin Sargent, Mary Sargent, Evelyn Rollinson, Frank Key, and Marjorie Mather, whose year's mind occurs in the course of this week. And as we remember those who have recently departed, we pray for Keith Pierce and Greta Hutchinson. Father, with Christ you raise the whole of creation to new life and new purpose. Bless Elizabeth our Queen and all who serve under her in elected office. Give new wisdom and fresh understanding to all in whose powerful hands lie the life and future of this world. Lord, in your mercy. Father, in baptism you have made the whole of the Church's life and worship into a sacrament of his resurrection. Bless and inspire Libby, our bishop, and all who are called to witness to the fullness of your life here and in eternity. Lord, in your mercy. Father, in Jesus the whole mystery of the Godhead was joined to the weakness and vulnerability of humankind. Through us we ask you to give hope to all who are in despair, love to all who are rejected, joy to all who are sunk in misery. Lord, in your mercy. Father, as you healed the sin of the world by raising Jesus, so in your spirit and through your people, we ask you to bring healing in body, mind, and spirit to all who suffer. Lord, in your mercy. Father, you invite all who believe in Christ to join him in that beginning of new life we celebrate today. When the time comes for our death, may we be joined with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the departed in your eternal life of love. Lord, in your mercy. Christ has conquered death and opened to all who believe the gate of eternal life. In that faith, we commit ourselves and all our prayers to God's mercy as we say, Merciful Father, hear. I now have to give you a second instalment of COVID instructions. I'd be grateful, particularly if you haven't been here for a long time, if you pay particular attention to this. If you wish to receive communion, the procedure for communion is as follows. Please come up the central aisle in a single file, maintaining a 2 meter distance at all times from anyone else. Because we have people in the side aisle on that side, the builders have prevented us using that side aisle, unfortunately. Because we have people in the side aisle, you will have to have a little patience and wait for people to come and go. The aim of the exercise is that we have a one-way system where people are coming up in a single file in the central aisle. Then after receiving communion, we'll return down here and down the side aisles, and if necessary, back up the central aisle to the place where they came from. So please be mindful of one another and use your common sense as you do that. When you arrive at the chancel step, please remain standing. Hold your hands out flat and as far as you can. Please do not hold your hands too high because it's quite difficult to get the host onto your hands if that's the case. Communion is only under one kind, under the form of bread at present. I will place the host on your hand without touching your hand. Please keep your thumb and anything else out of the way while I'm doing that. My hand-eye coordination is not particularly good, and if you make contact with my hand, we have to stop and everybody else has to wait while we do all the sanitizing. So please don't put us in that position. Take the host in your hand and then receive it immediately. You will be able to do that because you are requested to remove your face covering when you leave your seat and to put it back on when you get back. The aim of that exercise is to avoid hygiene issues with people fiddling with face coverings as they come up or when they arrive, and also the possibility of people dropping the host, and we like to keep respect for the sacrament in that way. So if you're coming to communion, those are your instructions. There are plenty of people, if you're not sure, still not sure exactly what to do, there are plenty of people who have been coming throughout the lockdown, and you'll be able to observe what they do. In the upper room, the Lord Jesus appeared to his disciples, and his first greeting to them was a greeting of peace. Alleluia! The peace of the risen Lord be always with you. Alleluia.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father, and in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell, and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. Lord, you are holy, indeed the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord,
by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
As it was perfect love that raised Jesus from the dead, so as John the Apostle tells us, perfect love casts out fear. We need not then be afraid of addressing God, as Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia! God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Over the past couple of weeks, it has sometimes seemed as if everything has been queuing up to spoil the celebration of Easter in this place. There have been limitations, there have been missing people, there's been all manner of things, and yet, we have not only marked an Easter which could have been notable for what wasn't done, we have marked an Easter which has been notable for the quality of its celebration. And for that I thank the teams who make up such an important part of this parish church. The flower team, the music team, the verger team, the welcomer team, all manner of the clergy team, I must mention them, all manner of different people have contributed towards the celebration today, and they have done so sometimes flying by the skin of their teeth. And I thank them for that, because the sign of a quality team is that you can produce a quality product even when circumstances mean that you have to fly by the skin of your teeth. I'm sure that's a terrible mixed metaphor, but it says exactly what I want it to mean. I want to say a particular word of thanks, and I will get into trouble for making this personal, but I'm still going to say a particular word of thanks to Josh, to Dominic, and to Helen, who have been at the core of a much bigger team who have made the services happen and have made sure this church is clean enough for you to celebrate today. I'd also like to say a special word of thanks to Dorothy, who has made it possible for all the wonderful flower ladies to work together to produce the flowers which are decorating the church today. Next year in Jerusalem, somebody said. Maybe next year somewhere else, but certainly next year in Chesterfield. If COVID has gone away, we have built a very good platform on which to have a wonderful celebration once again next year. So thank you to everybody who has been involved in making this happen. I am proud, as I so often am, to be Vicar of Chesterfield when I know I am working with people like you. Having said all that, we are going to be limited today because the lollipop, you remember Sir Thomas Beecham used to give people encores and call them lollipops at the end of his concerts. The lollipop for Easter is usually having an Easter egg thrown at you. That is not COVID secure. However, we are permitted to sing outside. So as for Christmas, we will sing an Easter hymn, not Christmas, it was a Christmas carol. We will sing an Easter hymn outside at the end of Mass. You will have found it in your pew sheet. So here are the instructions for the end of Mass. At the end, I and the choir will process to the back of the church and outside. I will be taking the camera with me. Please come outside, bringing all your stuff with you, and having your Jesus Christ is Risen Today sheet ready to join in the carol. As you go past the quarantine box, please put all the other pieces of paper except the pew sheet in the quarantine box and include the pen in that. I hope you've got me so far. So you're ready to do all that. We will gather outside to sing Jesus Christ is Risen Today. Please, at all times, keep 2 metres away from anyone who isn't in your bubble, even when you are outside. We are under scrutiny, and more so because there are CCTV cameras outside. So please be careful not to get us into trouble or not to get me fined for any COVID infringements. Now that is what we're going to do at the end of Mass. If you are happy to be on camera at the end of Mass, go to the left. If you are not happy to be on camera, go to the right, and I will try and remember not to film you singing. I hope that will be a good lollipop after all these weeks and months of not being able to sing hymns. Alleluia! Christ is risen!
He is risen indeed. Alleluia!
God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of the everlasting life. God the Son, who in bursting the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. God the Holy Spirit, whom the risen Lord breathed into his disciples, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace. And the blessing and the love of the Lord, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Let us go forth in peace. Alleluia. Alleluia.
You can take your masks off outside. Alleluia, a triumphum soli Dei. Alleluia, who did once upon the cross. Alleluia, suffer to redeem our loss. Alleluia. Hymns of praise then let us sing. Alleluia. Unto Christ our heavenly King. Alleluia. Who endured the cross and grave. Alleluia. Sinners to redeem and save. Alleluia. But the pains that he endured, alleluia, a salvation have procured. Alleluia. Now above the sky is King. Alleluia. Where the angels ever sing.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.